morning, good afternoon and good evening students. Today we are going to discuss lecture number 7th of chapter number 5th of subject economics, that is poverty. Till the day, in past 6 lectures, we have already discussed everything about the chapter poverty. That is, first of all we have discussed about the introduction, then the meaning of poverty, in which there is a traditional poverty and modern poverty. Then we have discussed about the absolute poverty and poverty line. Then moving forward, we have discussed about the relative poverty, and then 2 lectures full we have discussed about the various indicators that shows what is poverty and how the situation is very tough. Then in last 2 lectures, that is in lecture number 5th and 6th, we have discussed more about the reasons or causes of poverty. And in today's lecture, we are starting to discuss about the measures to reduce poverty. So today, we are interested in knowing about how to reduce poverty, and for that, we are having 7 measures and or 7 points that we will discuss today itself. So first of all, from page number 59, point number 5.5, measures to reduce poverty. India has taken the following steps to reduce poverty during planning period. I suggest you to first of all consider or read the indicators of poverty and the reasons of poverty, and then start learning or start understanding this chapter, because all these points are the measures, or it is the correction of the problems that we have discussed. So first of all, to increase agricultural productivity, in the last lecture in economic reasons we have discussed about the low agricultural productivity per labor. As India is heavily dependent on agriculture, we have to do something so that we can reduce the agricultural burden of population, and for that to increase agricultural productivity is one of the measure. Let us discuss. In India, one of the basic reason of poverty is low productivity in agriculture. Last time I have given one example there. Suppose in Australia, per labor productivity is 1000 kilogram, then in India we are having productivity of 600 kilogram only. That means compared to those countries, our productivity is very less. With increase in agricultural productivity and income of agricultural laborer, poverty can be reduced. Here there is one point, is that majority of population is dependent on agriculture. So if by the way and means we can increase the agricultural productivity, then up to some extent we are able to reduce the poverty or to increase the agricultural productivity. Regarding this, true. So how they means here they have given the solution that how we can increase agricultural productivity. So for that, through public programs, it means here the different agencies of the government are conducting seminars at a village level and conducting a different programs where there is a demonstration and fair exhibition, everything is happens, and which will increase or helpful in increase the agricultural productivity. Farmers are informed about upgraded technology. Instead of old age and traditional methods of farming, farmers are updated about all the new and latest machineries and tools that are helpful in increasing agricultural productivity will be upgraded. Or for that, different government agencies are working to inform the laborers or the farmers about latest and updated technologies. Available resources at reasonable rate. Sometimes it may happens that farmers get cheated by the way of duplicate fertilizers and pesticides. sometimes it may happens there due to very less knowledge about the tools and equipments which are available in the market. They are not able to getting the sufficient agricultural productivity. So here available means they are informing about the available resources at reasonable rates. Improved infrastructural facilities in which there is a proper infrastructural arrangement is there to getting the crop out of that field and to reaching up to the market. And for that, government is taking necessary steps so that each and every farmer get the benefit of their produce by themselves. Today, even in the situation like India, there is intermediaries who are the intermediary between farmer and customer are getting maximum benefit. But once the infrastructural facilities will improve or it can be developed, then we will be able to give them maximum satisfaction. Maximum price and regulated market for their produce. So now there is an APMC market at each district of the state in which there is a regulated market and maximum price where auction is going on, and from that auction or on the basis of this auction, the farmers are getting maximum price for their produce, which will helpful in reducing the poverty. Development of agriculture will increase productivity per labor if we implement all these steps which we have discussed, then it will result into higher productivity per labor or per hectare in the agricultural land. And once if productivity will increase, now farmer will get maximum benefit of their produce, or they can produce maximum with the smallest efforts, and that will helpful in increasing their income level. Also, employment opportunity and prices of food grain will decrease. Once, if production is higher, then they will get a higher level of employment, and by this way, the prices of food grain will decrease, because today we are not able to provide enough supply of raw materials or food grains. As you all know that for all the industries, the raw materials is agricultural produce. And for different kind of food grains and fruits and vegetables, we are also depending on agriculture. But if the agricultural productivity is less, then there will be lower supply and it will result into higher prices. So once agriculture productivity will increase, it will give more employment and prices of food grains will decrease. This will be more advantageous to the poor and poverty will be reduced. So once if we implement all these steps which we have discussed, which will increase the agricultural productivity, and by this way we can increase the income of farmers, and from this way we can reduce the poverty level. Now second point is development of small scale industries. As we have discussed in economic factors, that is point number 3, minimal development of small and cottage industry. As we all know, in India, majority of the population is dependent on agriculture. And because of that, there is a disguised unemployment is prevalent in agricultural sector. One of the reasons for this disguised unemployment is that there is a minimal development of small and cottage industries in India. If we develop this small and cottage industry to the highest extent, then and then it will be useful in reduction of poverty, because all those excess labors from agriculture will be moved towards the small scale industries, and in by that way we are getting a benefit in two different ways. First one is the burden of agriculture will reduce, and second, all the excess labor will get employment in the small scale industries. In India, small and cottage industries have made immense contribution in the gross national income and employment. That's why Indian government have put this small and cottage industries into priority list along with agricultural products. So, along with agricultural sector, small and cottage industries are also included in priority list, because small and cottage industries have made immense contribution in the gross national income and employment. So, if small and cottage industries can be developed and encouraged, if by any ways, we will discuss about the importance of small-scale industries and cottage industries in chapter number 10. So, by the way of different kind of incentives and benefits and facilities, if small and cottage industries can be developed and encouraged, then poverty can be reduced on a larger scale, because by this way, we are giving more employment to the laborers and their income level will be higher. Point number 3, development of unorganized sector. Basically, there is two kinds of sector is there, organized and unorganized. For each and every organized sector, whether it is agricultural, industrial or finance or marketing, there is some body who is monitoring and inspecting all the activities. While in unorganized sector, it works by itself. It means there is no requirement of any formal body. Unorganized sector includes, so who are those who are included in unorganized sector? First one is vegetable vendors, which we are seeing. Then masons in construction sector who are constructing. Agricultural laborers who are working in other field. Vendors or hawkers who are moving from one place to another place and they are selling the product. So in all these points, whether it is a vegetable vendor or masons in construction sector or agricultural laborers or vendors, they are included in unorganized sector, because for them there is no particular body who is monitoring or inspecting all these activities. To improve the condition of these workers, now though all those who are working in unorganized sector, there is no clear cut policy of a government which will beneficial to them. So their condition is very tough. So to improve the condition of these workers, National Commission has recommended to decide the working condition. Sometimes it may happen that they have to work for 12 hours or 15 hours a day. Sometimes they are working in a very dark room where there is no proper ventilation and air facility is available. So for them also, government has decided the working condition, which is given under the labor laws, that maximum work can be allotted to anyone is 8 hours. And if a person is able to work more than 8 hours, then he will be entitled to get extra payment as a overtime. Life insurance for them, government has started different life insurance policies also. Old age pension, because they are in unorganized sector, they are not employees. They are self-employed persons, so there is no pension at the after retirement age. But in some of the policies, government have tried to provide them old age pensions also. And other social security measures, which we will discuss in the employment programs and in some of the programs of chapter number 6. Moreover, for small and marginal farmers, it means all those small and marginal farmers who are working under the unorganized sector, it is recommended to provide them with irrigation facilities and loan facilities, where they are able to get irrigation loan or loan for their cropping pattern and loan for their agricultural activities. So it was a point number 3. That is development of unorganized sector. Let us move towards the point number 4, that is use of appropriate tax policy. Because if the tax rate is higher for all those who are working as a middle class or lower class, then poverty will be increased like anything. But if there is a proper taxation system is there, then and then it will be helpful to reduce the poverty level. See, basically there is 3 types of taxation policy. First one is flat. It means all are taxed same. It means whether it is a small businessman or large businessman or an employee or even unemployed person will be taxed as same amount. It is called flat taxation system. Second one is a regressive taxation system in which as your income increasing more and more, your tax amount will be reducing. And when your income increasing and tax reducing, it is called regression taxation policy or regressive taxation policy. And in India, we have employed progressive taxation policy. It is the third type, in which as your income increases, you have to pay more tax. And for poor and lower class people, up to 2,50,000 rupees as an income, it is tax free, means government is not charging a single rupee from all those whose income is less than 2,50,000. So basically there is three type of taxation policy: fixed taxation, regressive taxation and progressive taxation. In India, we are having progressive taxation policy. Government uses tax policy to reduce inequality of income and poverty by redistributing income. Understand one thing, it is very common. All those who are having higher income will be charged higher taxes. All these taxes collected by the central government. The central government accumulate all these taxes and use it for the benefit of poor. By this way, it will be the redistribution of income, and by this way, we can equate between the unequal distribution of income and property. Because all those who are poor and whose income is less than 2,50,000, they will be tax free. But as your income increases, like 10 lakh, 20 lakh, 30 lakh, 50 lakh, 1 crore, then there is a different tax rates are applicable, like 10%, 20%, 30%. And from this tax, the collection of revenue, which is collected by government, government will provide this amount as a benefit to all the poor, like PDS, that is public distribution system, different pension schemes, Jan Dhan Yojana and all. We'll discuss about this in the latter part of this chapter. Done? So, government use tax policy to reduce inequality of income and poverty by redistributing income. To fulfill this objective, the government makes such a policy wherein more tax is imposed on the rich class, which can afford that tax, and less tax is imposed on poor class and given tax concession. So, this policy is called progressive taxation system. In India, the government makes such a policy where more tax is imposed on rich class, means all those who are well equipped and well rich class people, which can afford that tax. Sometimes government imposing 33% tax. The maximum tax slab is 30%, but if your income is more than 1 crore, then there will be 3% of cess is applicable extra with this 30% of taxes. So it may happen that they have to pay majority portion of their income as a tax and they can afford it. And less tax is imposed on poor class. All those who are having very less income will have to pay a less tax. And sometimes it gives a tax concession, that is, they have to pay a zero tax on their income. This way, the government collects a fund by imposing taxes on rich people and makes expenses on welfare-oriented program for the poor people. As in today's condition, due to this COVID-19, there is a lockdown imposed by central government in India. But all the class of people are not alike, means they are not same. So rich and resourceful people are able to satisfy all their needs by their own. But there is a difficulty for living of all those who are below poverty line or average people. So, from this tax collected and from this source of income, government has decided to provide free meal to public by the way of free ration to them. through the public distribution system, in which every month government is giving 10 kg of wheat, 1 kg of sugar, 3 kg of rice, and etc. for the betterment of these poor people. So it is happens because the way of taxation policy. Government is charging a higher tax from the rich class of people and gives the benefit of this tax or collected fund to all those who are the poor class of people. So this way the government collects a fund by imposing taxes on rich people and makes expenses on welfare oriented program for the poor people, as we have already discussed. As a result, socio-economic condition of the poor improve, as we are seeing that due to this lockdown, people are not able to engage in any kind of economic activities and their income is zero. So, by this way, government can improve the socio-economic condition of the poor and reduction is income inequality and poverty is seen. And by this way, there will be the balance between poor class and rich class is slowly maintaining. Or we can say the gap between poor and rich class will be reducing slowly and it will result into equal distribution of income and property. Now, sorry, point number 5, rise in human capital investment. We have seen different kind of investment, but here human capital investment is a very large and big topic. Human is a capital which we have already discussed in chapter number 1 of subject OC. So human is a capital, but what is human capital investment? It means all the investment which is done for the betterment of a particular person by the way of education, health, nutritive food, proper drinking water, and everything is comes under the human capital investment. But in the situation of poverty, where people are not able to fulfill their basic needs, there is a very less chance of a rise in human capital investment because they cannot invest for the betterment of people in the situation where they are unable to getting even a food of a 2 times. So, once poverty will be reduced, so we will be able to increase the human capital investment. Developed nations where large-scale investment is made on education, skill development have very low level of unemployment. All the developed nations like USA, UK, Japan, they are having, Norway, they are having a large portion of their income for the human capital investment. They are investing maximum amount behind education, skill development and health activities. And that results in the low level of unemployment. As a result, poverty is less because their improvement is very high and by this way, the poverty is very less. High level of education satisfies the requirement of various employment opportunities. Once you are getting a higher level of education, then there will be more chance that you can shift from one employment opportunities to another employment opportunities very easily because you are qualified enough to switch between any of the working opportunity. So, the high level of education satisfies the requirement of various employment opportunities and choices among workers. Skill development increases the productivity of workers. Skill development is a one kind of training in which people are given training on the basis of their different skills and their qualification. So, skill development increases the productivity of workers and that reflects in higher wages. When your productivity will increase, it will be results into higher wages and you will be able to getting more than an average person. For that, at workplace, continuous investment is required for training and research. So, in developed countries, they are spending maximum amount on human capital investment by the way of training and research. But in developing countries where there is a widespread poverty, they are not able to spend much on human capital investment. But once the problem of poverty will be solved, will be able to increase our expenditure behind human capital investment, and it will result into higher employment and will beneficial to the poor. Point number 6, that is goods and services as reasonable rate. Here we will discuss about the purchasing power, which is also one of the topic of economic factors. To provide nutritive food and food security to poor people, it should be made available at reasonable rates, which will also directly reduce poverty. In India, we are having mixed economic system. That is, in one part we are socialist and in another part we are capitalist. As a part of socialist measures, the government is taking necessary steps to improve the conditions of lower class people, which can be called as a poor. And for that, government has made different kind of policies which will be helpful to the poor class people to improve their working conditions. And here, to provide nutritive food and food security to poor people, it should be made available at reasonable rate. And for that, government has started PDS, that is public distribution system, as we are seeing that Pandit Dindiyal Upadhyay ration shop is in each and every area of each and every city and villages. So by that way, the government is providing nutritive food and food security to poor people. This PDS system plus government has started midday meal scheme to all those students who are studying in the school and basically are poor class of people. And so it is also comes under the food security, which will also directly reduce poverty, because here government will provide them benefit by the way of charging a very less amount from this ration shop and providing essential goods at a very less rate. Under public distribution system in India, we have ration shops where rural and urban poor are given basic utility goods at reasonable prices. Here, government have established a policy in which all the necessity goods will be comes under the primary list of the government, and it can be distributed through public distribution system. That's why the prices of food grains is under the control of government. Because if the prices of food grains will increase, then it will result into the highest level of poverty. So that government is trying to provide food grains by the way of public distribution system to the rural and urban poor, where they are charging a very negligible amount from these people, and maximum benefit will be given to the BPL class of people, that is below poverty line, those who are having yellow ration cards. During drought and scarcity, as we are saying that, it is also the situation like drought and scarcity where the COVID-19 pandemic is widely spread into the Indian economy, and majority of the people who are suffering from this are not able to work. And in such kind of situation like drought, scarcity and pandemics, the responsibility of public distribution system is more to satisfy the basic needs of the poor. As we are seeing that, since last 2 months, government is providing free food grains from this public distribution system to the BPL and APL 2 class of people. Seventh and last one is the employment programs, in which we are going to discuss. First one is IRDP. That is Integrated Rural Development Plan or Suvarna Jayanti Gram Swarojgar Yojana. Then wage employment schemes, in which we will discuss some of the wage employment scheme. Prime Minister Rojgar Yojana, that is PMRY. National Rural Employment Guarantee Act 2005, that is NREGA, which will be known as a MG NREGA nowadays. Housing scheme, Social Security scheme, and lastly, we will discuss about the Jan Dhan Yojana. In this particular lecture, that is in lecture number 7, we are not able to cover all these programs in this lecture because of the limitation of time. So we will be having lecture number 8 on specifically employment programs. And one thing I want to clear is that the board will ask this employment program separately also. So don't worry, we'll discuss each and every program in detail in next lecture. Thank you very much, class.